Up to now, luminosities, fluxes, luminosity distances, and flux densities are not that hard to grasp. Perhaps CGS units are a bit weird, but that's it. What we're going to define is the concept of magnitude. The system is very weird, non-intuitive, but it was first introduced to essentially try to class stars into number one being very bright and number six being not so bright. This was conceived hundreds of years ago, but we now have a modern definition that is still very confusing and non-intuitive, but that at least it's very quantitative. Now, magnitudes are sometimes called apparent magnitudes, and that is because they correspond very, very closely to what we just discussed in terms of fluxes or flux densities in a log form. That is important to point out. And this means that magnitudes depend on the distance to the source. If you are further away from the same source, the magnitude will actually be fainter than if you're close to it. And that is the reason why we'll also define other kinds of magnitudes, which are called absolute magnitudes with a capital M that you can see here. And they are defined as being the apparent magnitude as if we were to place the source 10 parsec away. And the difference actually between the apparent magnitude and the absolute magnitude is related to the distance. And this is what in astronomy we call the distance modulus. But we'll define all these quantities and very, very accurately. Now, just to point out before you really hate astronomers for using CGS units, they are widely used in astronomy and astrophysics, one hand for historical reasons, but also because they can be quite useful actually. And they're more related with the typical sizes of instruments that have centimeter squared areas and not meter squared areas. On the other hand, you could think that the international system, even though you're familiar with it and it's very clean and nice, it doesn't really give you any physical insights into astronomy because the numbers are really, really so big anyway. Therefore, there's no big advantage in using the international system apart from perhaps keeping sane if you can't deal with CGS units. I'll try my best to give you examples in CGS and international units and show you how you can benefit from both of them. Now, before we properly define what a magnitude is or an apparent magnitude, it is good to have a look at the history of how this concept came about. And basically, it was a means through which the ancient Greeks assign classification to a star in terms of its apparent brightness. Now, because this was before the invention of zero, then the brightest star would be classed as a one. So the brightest star in the sky has a magnitude of one. And then they would rank stars in the equivalent to a logarithmic system, according to our own eyes, where star with a magnitude of six would be the dimmest at the naked eye limit. Now, the important thing to understand is that because of the system, number one being the brightest, six being the dimmest, then the dimmer you are, the larger the magnitude. So this is where this comes from. And in practice, the magnitude system, even in the Greeks, was a relative system. So once you figure out what your magnitude system is, you can have a reference. The way to express magnitudes is essentially in terms of differences. So a magnitude one minus some reference magnitude is equal to minus 2.5 log 10 of the ratio of the fluxes. The flux of your star one and the flux of your reference. In other words, you can write this simply in terms of a ratio of fluxes. Flux one divided by the reference flux is equal to 10 to the power of mref minus m1 over 2.5. This obviously means there's consequences in terms of the full range of the Greek system of magnitudes from magnitude one to six, is that the magnitude one star was 100 times brighter or with a higher flux than the magnitude six star. And within the system, and the scaling and the way it changes is actually still the same, we're going to define it, but every time the magnitude changes, for example, by minus one, like you can see here, then you're increasing the flux by a factor of 2.5, roughly. And when the magnitude goes up by plus one, then what you're actually doing is multiplying by a factor of almost 0.4. So it is important to keep in mind that when the magnitude goes up, you're becoming fainter. When it goes down, then the brightness is increasing. Now, it is important, obviously, to mention that the Greeks already knew objects that would break the historic magnitude scale. For example, I mean, this is Greece, so there's the sun. In Lancaster, maybe you wouldn't be aware of this thing, which is incredibly bright. And we're going to be able to calculate the magnitude, but the magnitude of the sun, the apparent magnitude, is minus 26.7, definitely below one. But other objects, such as planets, Mars, will change its magnitude because it depends on the distance. The moon also, because it depends on the phase, but it's typically for a full moon, it's something like minus 13 almost. Venus is also quite bright, but also nebulae on the sky that can be very bright. Now, because of all this, it is important to define magnitudes in the modern way. And what are the systems that we're going to use? Because nicely defined also in the international system is to use the equation as we've seen before. So this is still the definition. The some magnitude one minus a reference magnitude will be equal to minus 2.5 log 10 of the ratio of the fluxes between something you want to calculate or know and your reference. Our reference for this system, which is called the Vega system, is the star Vega. It makes sense. And the way we're going to set this up is actually to say that Vega in the system, by definition, has a magnitude of zero. Let's not say it's magnitude of one, but it's magnitude of zero. And obviously, this system is unbound, so it's okay if things are brighter than Vega, we don't care. But it means that we can write that the reference magnitude is zero. How are we going to calibrate this? Well, one of the nice ways is we can, from here, from Earth, we can point a telescope or just get a detector and we can measure the flux of Vega in international system units. This is how much it comes out of Vega here on Earth. Now, if you do that, you could actually very easily place here the flux. And because as a reference, this is zero, this term vanishes, and we can very directly get a magnitude of any star given that we measure the flux of that star. But there's also kind of an easier and empirical way that you can rewrite the equations that is used a lot in astronomy, and that's why I'm introducing it here. And hopefully you can follow where this comes from. This will rely on the introduction of this ZP. This is a zero point. And the reason why this is used a lot in astronomy is because we can very easily calculate it for different instruments. For now, the important thing is to realize that for the Vega system, all we're doing is if you take this equation, we're essentially just using the properties of logs, right? So if you have a division, you can transform that into a minus because it's minus, minus, this becomes a plus. And all we're doing is this term of plus 2.5 log 10 flux of Vega, we're just calling it the zero point of the Vega system, right? This is all it is. Because this is a fixed value, the flux that reaches the Earth, then we can actually calculate it. And it turns out that this zero point is minus 18.87 in the Vega system. The reason why this is nice and useful is that for the Vega system, this is the equation you can use to calculate the magnitude of any star, provided that you measure its flux, the flux of the star in international system units, that's watt per square meters. If you subtract 18.87, you get the magnitude. Now, one thing that I wanted to point out, we're not going to use this explicitly, but there are many other magnitude systems. And one of them that is used a lot in the field that I work on in extragalactic astrophysics is the AB system. So it looks very similar to the Vega system in terms of how it is defined, with the big difference being that typically the fluxes we use will be in Jansky. I know we're astronomers, it can be very weird. And then there's just a zero point that is calibrated in some other way. But the equations, as you can see here and here, are incredibly similar. It's just that the calibration is done differently. So for the Vega system, we use Vega. For other systems, we just need to use something else, either another star or just artificial flux that we calibrate it to.